All right, let's start. Welcome everyone. My name is Mateusz Pusz. I'm the Chief Software Engineer at EPAM Systems, and also I'm a private trainer and consultant in my free time. Today we are going to talk about the software engineering, and we are going to find out that often there is no such thing as a golden bullet, no such thing as the best solution. Often we have to do some trade-offs, and we are going to talk about them. But first, let's talk about the software design as an art. Basically, the problem solving always depends on the point of view. You as an architect, or basically software architect, has to talk with different customers, different people that are interested in the product, right? And they often have different points of view. Managers have different point of view. Test team have different point of view. Developers have different point of view. Architects have different point of view. Higher management have different point of view. So they have different expectations, requirements, concerns, and constraints regarding the product, right? Sometimes those are even conflicting ones. And it's really hard to actually gather all of this feedback and have like one unified view. Because this is the what an architect has to do, right? It has to talk with people, it has to gather the requirements, have to create high-level view on the entire product, trying to satisfy all of the requirements if possible, right? So basically, when you gather this high-level view over a project, you can actually find things that specific people do not see by themselves, because they just scope on their narrow area of the expertise in the project. And they don't see the whole picture, right? The big picture here. And you can actually find out that something is missing, something is wrong, something is unstable, something should be refactored, enforced, or replaced in order to basically make the product safer, better, and so on. And basically, even when you do all of this stuff, you have to basically find and implement the solution. And sometimes it turns out that there are different possible solutions, and sometimes it even it's not that expensive to implement then, but the most time is actually you can spend finding out what's the best answer. And this is the reason why I'm so inefficient at my work, right? As it's stated here. Because this is not that easy at all in some cases. And we are going to analyze some of those today. Sometimes you just have to do some trade-offs, right? There are trade-offs regarding the architecture, but there are also trade-offs regarding the resources, for example. You may have limited resources, human resources, to implement something, or you may have limited time resources, like you don't have like 2 years to for the product to be released, yes? So it's not only about the designing, about the interfaces, about the C++ by itself, but also regarding the some other constraints, but we're not going to talk about those other constraints today. We are just scope on design phase. So the rest of the talk puts us in the product architect shoes. During the talk, you will be able to actually take some votes in a poll that I will share with you on your best preferred approach or your best preferred solution for the problem that I'm describing. So please pay attention. And please be ready later on to basically poll on the best solution. So, first problem is, what is the best string? If we look to the simplified basically implementation or high-level view over the string, std string, it's often or nearly always implemented in terms of three things: pointer, size, and capacity. This is how the string should look like, right? And GCC took this particular design where you have a pointer, size, and capacity plus some padding is shared together with small string optimization buffer that is being implemented in every standard string in every library. So each library uses a small string optimization, but each of them may choose to do it differently because it's not the part of the standard, it's implementation-specific stuff. So in case of GCC, We have this 16 byte characters buffer, which with the last character being zero, so there is 15 characters for the content in case the string is short, right? And does it need basically the dynamic allocation? It comes with some cost because the GCC string is 32 bytes long. It has additional padding in order to satisfy this size, because basically in case of non-small stack optimization case, this field is not used at all. But a good thing here is that basically pointer and the size and all of the members depending on those, like begin and indexing operator size and many others, basically work directly on data. So there is no branch to be taken on those member functions. Only if you want to verify capacity, so in functions like pushback, for example, and then you have to make a branch to check if you are in the regular mode or in small string optimization mode, and then based on the branch, you basically provide a specific value for capacity, either the size of the dynamically allocated memory, or basically 15, because this is the fixed size of the buffer, right? But as I said, there are different possible implementations. So this is GCC, but for example, LLVM chose otherwise. LLVM chose, again, capacity size pointer, but they chose to provide the small stack optimization buffer for on the entire size of, and the size of is 24 bytes this time. The last one is zero, as in the case of this one, because string in standard has to be zero terminated. And the first flag is basically first is mode. It's flag of the deciding which mode we are in. This allows us to put 22 cars of data in 24 bytes of size. So it's efficient on the size level. But on the other hand, every operation done on string has to check the mode flag to find out in which basically state we are in and how to find the answer for what is the capacity, what is the size, what is the data pointer to your string. So this is size efficient, also the basically CPU cache line efficient, right? But may have some additional costs with runtime, connected to runtime because of this branch being taken. Of course, we have really nice branch predictors in the hardware, but still a branch is in the code. And there is one more implementation that is really similar to this one. You may be aware of this one. It's in Facebook's string, in library Folly. Through some interesting engineering practices, basically they were able to put 23 characters in this buffer. And the magic is with the last byte here, because basically this one determines the size of the string, but it's not size, it's like capacity minus size. So basically when you are out of the capacity, it says zero. And if it's zero, it actually serves as the last character in the buffer. So it's really interesting design. For sure, excuse for this case, it has 23 characters of data for 24 characters of the size. It's a really nice engineering choice to do so. So there are three different possibilities here, and we are going to find out which one is the best one. When I was looking for some answers or some maybe comments on why specific designs were selected by specific vendors, I found some answers and some posts from Howard Hinand, which is the author of LLVM string and also the author of StudChrono, that I love as probably the best library in the part of the standard library that we have. Howard said that major design goal was to minimize size of string. Minimizing size of string allows us to speed move construction and move assignment, right? Because basically move of the string is basically copying these contents, those three things, pointer, size, and capacity, right? So the larger the size of, the more words you have to move during move construction and move assignment, right? So basically, in case of GCC, move operation should be more expensive. Also, we're asked about the Folly's design, so basically Facebook's one. He said that, yeah, this is really clever. However, It would require libc++ to give up on one characteristic that he likes. Basically, a default constructed string is all zero in LLVM. That makes the default construction super efficient, right? Because it's just a memory of zeros. So you can zero out memory and put like 100 strings there. And it works. With the other alternatives, for example, for Folly, always you have to put this inverse of the size, so a capacity for default constructed buffer, so it's not that cheap for default construct at all. So now we have three different versions, right? With the summary of size, and the one in blue is basically the better solution for the specific category. Small string size is the biggest one for Folly. Move performance is the best for the LLVM. Branches for capacity only, not for all of the code in runtime. And LLVMs is the fastest to default construct, because the Folly's one needs to set this capacity there. And basically in GCC, we are setting the pointer to point to small string optimization data. And this is how the basically branch is being detected. So let's run the first poll and find what's the answer. I will give like 30 seconds to decide. And in the meantime, while you are voting, I see that there's a question. I have an idea how MSV string is implemented. I must admit I didn't check, sorry. So probably maybe someone can answer this from the audience if they know, but I didn't check how basically the Visual Studio chose. I think that it's one of implementations, either GCC or LLVM, but I'm not sure why, which one. I see some votes being taken, and I will stop the poll soon. So if you want to vote, please do so. Okay, let's stop the poll. The results are basically the following ones, that this audience prefers the LLVM approach. The 64 persons that voted preferred LLVM approach, 29 persons preferred GCC, and 7% of people preferred the Folly's solution. And this is interesting, and basically, as I said, there is no good answer, not the best answer here. There are always trade-offs, so it's hard to judge which one is the best one, and I can imagine that the architect of specific library for specific compiler has a really hard choice here to actually find out what's the best solution for the specific case, right? And the standard doesn't help here. Standard doesn't say exactly what should be the size, what should be the size of the small string optimization buffer, and actually it is good, because standard should not enforce everything. Okay, so let's see the next thing. The next thing is about variants. And something wrong happened to my slides. What happened? Sorry, I will just refresh. Maybe it will help. Yeah, it helps. Okay. Okay, so let's talk about the different variants of exception safety. And yeah, let's imagine we have some library. It has established connections function, and it has some range of ports from the first port to the last port that's being provided to establish connections. So from 1 to 20. As this may throw, we have some try catch block that basically handles the exception. We may have a connection that basically takes the port, and sometimes if the port cannot be established, there can be an exception during construction, right? It has a getter, nothing fancy here, and a vector of connections. And now, as we know that sometimes connection cannot be established, we are having a function established connection that has a retry number of 10, retry count of 10, right? And you are checking while connections are empty or connections back.port, so the last port being established is different than the last one that we were about to do so, we didn't finish. So we want to try again. So we basically from the last one being used and until the last one to be provided by the user, we are adding the missing connections. Right? If the exception happen, we are catching it, decrementing the retry number, cutting the exception, retrying if it's still valid. Otherwise, we are rethrowing the exception, stating that basically we failed to establish the connections for 10 tries. And now let's discuss how, in such case, add connection can be implemented. The easiest one with the vector that we mentioned, it is just that. Right, connections and place back port. That is caused by the fact that nearly entire C++ standard library tries to be a strong exception saved by default. Right? We probably know what it means. I will tell about this in a second. But first, I would like to ask you, even if you know what it means, how often do you analyze exception safety of your code? Because from my experience, when I talk to people as a consultant or as an interviewer, I know that people know strong exception safety guarantees, but when I ask, what was the last time you reviewed the exception safety of your algorithm? How often do you analyze exception safety of your custom class assignment operator? Or which exception safety the latest library utility written by you provides? People are basically concerned because and confused because actually we are not thinking about that writing our code. We know what it means, we know what it does, we know how to use it. We expect this from the standard library, but in many cases, we don't care writing our own code. This is my observation. Of course, I may be wrong. For sure, some of you think about it. For sure, there are some companies having practices that enforce you to verify the exception safety guarantees. So I don't want to generalize here. But from my experience as a trainer, as a consultant, as an interviewer, it's often the case. So talking about exception safety guarantees, right? We have four of them. First one says that basically function is no except. Exception will never leave this function, right? The last one basically says that there's no exception guarantee. In this case, it's the only case actually when the program is unstable, when the program is unsafe, it can leak, it can basically do more corruption, blue screen, kernel panic, whatever, right? Because it's a bad written program. With strong exception guarantee or basic exception guarantee, we have some guarantees. With strong one, basically it's like a transaction. If the function basically starts to do something and some changes and exception is being thrown, it has to rewind, undo control Z, right? All of the changes that were done by this function up to this point. So it's like a transaction, either everything happens or nothing at all. So from the user point of view, it's really useful because user can just assume that this function was never called and maybe try again or do something else. No cleanup is needed. In case of basic exception guarantee, basically it means that the application is still in a valid state. The state is being documented by specific library feature, but you may be forced to do some checks or some cleanup in order for the program to continue. As I stated, even if theoretically known to developers, exception safety guarantees are often ignored in the production code. Imagine having the standard library with only basic exception safety guarantee. So we'll have add connection with our port, and instead of just having emplace back, we'll have, for example, to check if connections are not empty. And if the last one provided in the container is dirty, because basically it failed to be established, we have to erase it. And then emplace back again, try to emplace back again the new port, right? Because it can, for example, throw again and do some problems for us. It would be a nightmare for everyone to work on a vector like this, right? This is not what we want to have from the libraries. But often we either not provide any exception safety guarantees in our code, or if we do, those are sometimes not strong ones. And I find it the most common in the case of assignment operators, which are really hard to write by hand, so you shouldn't, just do rule of zero. But if you are doing those, basically please think about the assignment operator implementation. But as I said, it's true for most of the standard library, but not for all of those types there. One of the the exceptions here is variant. Variant has so-called values by exception state, right? So basically, variant by itself cannot be empty. Empty is an invalid state in variant, but it can become empty during exception handling. Imagine having two types, A and B. Those types are basically types of the variant, right? In order to switch the variant from A to B, first you have to destruct A. You are destructing A and then trying to construct B in place of the same memory size, right? Because it's a union, to put the same B inside. If the B fails, there's no way to return A to the user, right? Because you just destructed it. So you cannot provide strong exception safety guarantees with this design. Right? And that's why we have values by exception state, and basically you have to check it every time before when an exception happens. For example, let's assume that you have some basic socket and a fast socket, and fast socket during construction can fail because, for example, kernel bypass drivers are not installed, right? And you have a variant of those. And then if you have some function process that works on a socket, we may want to try to switch a socket to a fast one. And if it fails, basically with some exception, you have to find out if it was a variant and if it's in the values by exception state. And if it is, it has to reset the socket to the basic socket again. This is what we pay for the stored variant to have only basic exception guarantee instead of the strong one. So is it possible to make a strong exception safety for variant? Yes, it is, but it comes again with the engineering trade-off. For example, boost variant has never empty guarantee. Never empty guarantee boost variant works as follows, that in case of potentially throwing copy construction, we are copying constructing the content of the left-hand side to the heap as a backup, so we have to dynamically allocate memory and copy the data there. So you're paying for allocation and for the copy, right? We destroy the content in variant, try to copy construct the object in the place of the union. If it fails, we have to copy the backup back to the original state. So we provide strong exception safety guarantee. In the path of success, we just deallocate the data, right? The backup. So to provide a strong exception safety guarantee with potential cost of a dynamic memory allocation and a copy. Also, there is no control over the allocator support, so you cannot choose your own allocator in some constrained environments. And talking about constrained environments, maybe even dynamic allocation memory is not allowed for you, like in the embedded, for example, right? Or life critical software. There cannot be no allocation. So in such case, stood variant, if basically standard committee chose this design, would not be possible to be used in such software at all, right? So again, let's try to vote. Let's try to vote on both solutions. First, we have stood variant that provides basic exception safety only. So invalid state is possible. We have to manually clean up when needed, but it never allocates memory. It's faster and can be used in embedded or constrained environments. Boost variant, non-invalid state, easy to use, no need to manual cleanup, but it may be slower, may fail, there's no allocator support. Some projects will never be allowed to use this one. So what's your choice here? Let's see. In the meantime, I see there's in a Q&A a question, what if copy from basically backup back to boost variant fails? Shit happens sometimes. Yeah, sorry. I didn't analyze exactly the code. I think that in such case, a variant may basically rethrow the exception, but I'm not sure because I didn't actually check that code in that detail. But basically, if you are able to copy first the same type from one place to another, then copying it back with the same state should be possible as long as things like memory still is accessible, right? In case of out of memory, basically you are dead anyway as a program, right? And even the biggest experts in this domain basically say that probably to terminate is the best solution rather than the exception. And doing this as an exception was a mistake. Okay, we are still voting. I will give you like 5 more seconds because I see that 75% voted only. Okay, we are ending the poll. And actually, it seems that the ISO committee did a great job because it seems that 94% of this audience chose the std variant solution. So, yeah, so it seems that we are having a good design in our default standard library, the one that is preferred by people here. But please be aware for your future projects that std variant is not a strong exception safe, right? You have to check if an exception happens. If it's not variant, and if it's variant, you have to make some cleanup. Because this is what we are paying for, having all the basically those benefits. Okay, we're going to the third problem right now, and I see that after every poll I have some issue. I don't know why. So please allow me to fix this. And okay, we are going to work right now to move to my field of expertise. I'm doing the MP Unis library. It's a physical Unis library for C++. And I have some design problems there, and I would like to ask you for feedback before this is released. This is standardized potentially as the part of the C++ standard library in the future. I don't say that it has to be done or will be done as this one, but if it happens to be some part of the standard library, right now you have the possibility to basically influence the design of this library, how it will look like in the future. But first we need to provide some introduction. Basically, quantity is a property or of a phenomenon, body of substance, where the property has a magnitude that can be expressed by means of a number and a reference. And the reference can be a measurement unit, right? So a quantity is something like 123 kilometers of length, right? So a magnitude, unit, and maybe some additional information about the dimension where we are working with, or 70 kilometers per hour of speed. Because of this, a quantity class template in my library and in most other libraries looks similar. We have some dimension, unit of this dimension, and a representation type, by default double. And assuming that there are no helpers in the library, in order to create an instance of a quantity, you'd have to type all of this information every time, right? Units quantity, units ISQ SI dim length, units ISQ SI kilometer, and then value. If you want to have something different than double, you have to put int additionally. That's quite verbose, right? And probably none of us would like to do it on a daily basis. So let's find some helpers that will allow us to create quantities in a better way, in a more improve the user experience here. So the first solution are dimension-specific aliases. So for example, we can make an alias template called length that will expose unit and representation type to the user, but dimension length will be fixed in a quantity already. So user will not have to provide this first path of this first part of the dimension length, and the same for speed. With this, it will look as follows, right? SI length of kilometer, SI speed of kilometer per hour. Basically, the pros here is that this is cheap to standardize because it's only one per dimension and there is basically a limited number of dimensions in the SI system, for example, even though it's big, but still it's about 100 or a bit more. Fast to compile because this is just an alias template. Alias templates are the fastest to compile from templates. Work buffs for literal and regular variables, right? By this, I mean that you can provide a compile time literal here, but also, for example, a runtime variable or a function argument. And it will work fine. Cons. still quite verbose to type, right? For example, namespace has to be repeated for a unit, right? Namespace here, namespace here. Cluster pre-argument deduction for alias templates does not work here, so we cannot deduce a representation type from the initializer. So we have to put int here because it will not be deduced from this initializer by itself. Because this here alias templates deduction will not help. So let's try to find something shorter. So let's see some solution number two. Let's provide an alias not for each dimension only, but also for each unit in the library. With this, we can create some namespace called length, and in this namespace length, we'll have kilometer as a unit. Only representation type will be exposed to the user, and everything else will be fixed. And the same for speed. With this, we can type the code as short as this one, SI length kilometer, SI speed kilometer per hour. We can use cluster pre-argument deduction, because this is the only template parameter that's being deduced, so the representation, right? So in this case, this one will deduce double, this one will deduce integer. Or if we decide that we want to be more terse, because we know exactly what's the context, we can additionally include the SI namespace and those were inlined there, so you can just use kilometer, kilometer per hour to create those literals. So this is the shortest solution here, right? And this is more verbose, but it may be useful for some cases where basically something like L, T, or M, or S are basically something that may be hard to find out that is a second liter, tone, or meter, right? So good part, good sides of this one. It's fast to compile because this is another alias template. Works both for literal and integral variables, right? Because you can provide runtime object or compile time value and it works fine. User can choose to either use a long or terse version, depending on the context. Cons? It's quite expensive to standardize and implement, right? Because it's every unit of every dimension. So this comes in thousands. So let's analyze solution number three. We name this quantity references, and we create a reference type that basically is just stores information about the dimension and the unit. So nearly all of quantity stores besides the representation. So you have such a reference that stores information about dimension and the unit. And this is for kilometer, this is for hour. We have some additional here helper namespaces here. I will tell why in a second. And then we have syntax, multiply syntax, that basically creates a quantity. So a value times the reference gives us the quantity. In order for the reference to work with something more complex, you have to put them in parentheses. So you have reference created dynamically from kilometer per hour and then multiplied by magnitude. So this parenthesis is mandatory, otherwise the design will be broken. And too hard to basically it will be more yeah it will be harder to work with. You can also easily create this temporary by yourself. Name it kilometer per hour and just use kilometer per hour for you. So it's really easy to create custom basically references derived from the existing ones. Pros: medium effort to standardize as provided only for named units. Named units is not like thousands. It's much less. Those are base units of seven dimensions plus something like watt, joule, and a few more, right? For derived quantities. Works both for literals and regular variables again. And easy to compose custom references for unnamed derived units. However, it's slower to compile because this requires class template instantiations rather than just alias templates. Sometimes it's awkward to type and understand, like 20 meters per second divided by 10 meters per second squared. Right? All of those parentheses are strange here. And why you had those inline namespaces? Because basically those are objects and they often collide with variables that we have in our or function parameters that we have already in our code base, like things like meter, ton, newton, right? We probably use n a lot for std array, right? and other sizes for templates. And this will collide with your code. That's why we have those inline namespaces. You can prefix the reference with the namespace if needed to disambiguate the code. Sometimes it's also hard to understand because it's really terse. For example, if you have something like d and t as that distance and time, then d times m, t times s looks strange, right? You can sometimes may forget that m is a meter, s is a second, those are references, and those actually are variables. Everything looks like a variable, and for someone it may be hard to understand the context here, right? That we are basically creating quantities, not just multiplying some objects, some variables. And the last solution, the solution that every one of you knows already. So use the different literals. Also, we had a really nice talk about UDLs from Pablo. So if you are interested in this subject, please go and see this one. And here's the solution. The solution is basically compatible with what we have in StudChrono, right? So we have a literal for integral value, literal for the floating point value, and it's provided for every single unit in the library. When you want to use it, basically it's what you expect, right? You provide some double, some integer, and it works. Notice that even though I provided double here, I got long double as a representation type. Even though I provided integer here, I got int 6040 as a representation type, because this is what's being hard-coded in this code. This is how UDLs work. Pros. Compatible with what we have and know and use with StudChrono duration. Terse and easy to understand. However, it's the slowest to compile. The most expensive to standardize because it's 2 times per each unit in the system. Works only for literals. For compile time known values, right? It will not work for common variables, function parameters, and so on, because you cannot state like a meter, right? You just have to provide the literal, the value always. And actually, values, from my experience, are used either for physical constants, which are not that big number, and for unit tests, what is really useful. But for runtime code, for production code, in most cases, literals are not that useful. Also, as I mentioned, there is no control over the representation type. Only int 6040 or long double is being provided to the user, even if you're choosing the different representation as an input. And also, UDLs cannot be disambiguated with namespace name. So if you have collision of the same unit, for example, centimeter in a SI or CGS system, then you have basically a collision program will not compile because you will not be able to specify which centimeter did you mean, because you cannot prefix the UDL with the namespace name in the current C++ language. Of course, we could make all of the solutions work at once in the standard library. It works them. They work all of them. All of them work nicely in my library right now. But of course, it may not be the best solution. Standardization takes time, right? And probably if you just put it and write it in the committee, it will not be accepted. They will ask me to choose something, right? Time is needed to discuss stuff in working groups, prepare the ISO specification, implement this in various implementations of standard library, and then teach and learn, right? Why should we teach and learn 3 different stuff to do the same, right? Let's choose the best one. So just as a summary, we have comparison here. This is how dimensional aliases looks like. This is how unit aliases look like for the verbose and terse form. Quantity references and UDLs. And here is the list of all of the properties that I gathered for all of those solutions. And blue, as always, is a good feature. And we are still talking about literals and variable support, preserving user providing representation type, explicit control over the representation type, so you can overwrite it, readability, possibility to resolve ambiguity, hard to resolve shadowing issues, control verbosity, easy composition for derived units, implementation and standardization effort, compile time performance. And again, let's try to choose what's the best solution. What would you like to see, possibly in C++ 26? In a units library. Okay, we are still voting. Actually, I did the same vote on the NDC Tech Town conference a week ago, and I'm happy to see that basically results are really similar. So it seems that basically audience on conferences have the same point of view on the on specific problems being discussed here. So it's actually encouraging, and thank you for this input. I will close it in 5 seconds. So you still have possibility to vote. Okay, so let's see. 68% of people preferred the solution number 2, unit aliases. So the one when you can choose the variable city, and basically something that's different than the std kernel duration. And for the rest, we have nearly the same, like 19% for the first one, 19% for the third one, and 17% for user-defined literals. So it seems that user-defined literals are the least preferred solution here, but basically just by 2% from the other two of here. So probably they all should be treated as the same in this case. But thank you for the feedback. I'll make it work. And actually, I probably also talk about physical units library on the NDT Tech Town. It should be online soon. And as the audience chose the best one, this one as the best one also, all of my talk was basically rewritten in the evening before to this solution. So I basically played all of the slides with this approach. So if you're interested how it impacted the design, the user look and feel, please find this talk and see if basically you have if it works nicely for you. And the downcasting facility, the last problem that we are going to discuss today. And again, something broke after pulse. It's strange that pulse broke it, break it always. Okay. I will not talk much about the design of the downcasting facility. If you're interested, I provided this design insights in my different talks about the physical unit library or basically doing template metaprogramming in modern C++. But I will just refresh what it is about and basically what are the benefits of it. So benefits are when you're typing something like average speed, length and time, and you want to get speed, right? This is a function template because we have those autos here. If you see auto, it means that there's template under the hood. And we are dividing distance by time, getting speed. We can print the speed here and return speed to the user, right? And then user can basically, I call average speed with kilometers and hours, and we'll get the printing here in kilometers per hour. This is thanks to the downcasting facility, because we know in this case that we are dividing distance by time, that we are actually creating a speed dimension and a unit for speed rather than just some synthetically generated quantity of exponents. So if you look actually in the debugger to this class, to the type of this class, it will be a quantity of dimension speed in unit kilometer per hour, which gives a great user experience for the user. And just to make it straight, this library basically is mostly only to generate the errors and debugging experience, right? And probably errors is the most important ones. If we were flawless, if we were never basically creating errors in our code, this library is useless because it doesn't provide any additional features for you. If you know exactly when to multiply things and divide things and what should be the magnitude and what should be the constant provided for multiplication, then you can write it by yourself, by hand, right? You don't need those helpers. You don't need to be checked at compile time. The main purpose of creating such a library is to generate compile time errors many times a day for an engineer that might not necessarily be a good C++ developer because he's doing engineering and sometimes he even don't know what a template is or metaprogramming is, right? We want to provide the best user possible experience to such people that have to deal with quantities and they don't know how to analyze 5 screens of compiler error. Basically, a short mention how it's being implemented is that we have derived dimension with all of those exponents like length and time. This is speed created by the engine. And user in the code of speed dimension, speed quantity, derives from derived dimension a user-defined type. And the same is for unit, like kilometer per hour. So user knows that speed is such thing. And we also have to teach the compiler that such thing is a speed. And this is done by those additional two classes that are basically provided here with CRTP pattern. So class temperature, curiosity querying template parameter idiom, right? And this one allows us to actually say, hey, framework, if you see type like this one, user provided this one. So please switch it to this one and use this one in further code. This is how downcasting facility works at compile time. It is great. It provides really nice user experience, but there is one thing that was noted some time ago, that it's possible to break one definition rule easily with that. One definition rule is defined in C++ language for two different scopes. One is translation unit, and it says that only one definition or variable or function class can be provided in basically translation unit. And this is why we provide all of those header guards to not provide duplicated definitions in the same file, right? And there is another scope called program, right? An entire program has to have one definition of every non-inline function variable, or every inline function variable has basically have definition in every place when it's being used, because otherwise we'll not be able to inline its code. And also classes have to be provided only once in entire program and should be visible in places when it's basically being used, the declaration of it. But this is C++, right? So in C++, we have always some exceptions from the rules. There can be more than one definition in a program, as long as each definition appears in different translation units, right? Because we just said that for one translation unit, we cannot repeat the definition. Each definition consists of the same tokens, so it's like on a lexer level. And it has to be exactly the same to the compiler. If something doesn't look the same for the compiler, has the same name, but looks differently, basically the linker is allowed to choose one of those and the compiler doesn't care and the language doesn't care because it's undefined behavior. You should not do this. So let's see how we can break one definition rule with this approach. Let's have our average speed that we discussed so far. Right? And let's have one translation unit that includes our average speed algorithm and provides speed as a user provided type. This is defined there, right? This dimension speed and kilometer per hour. And then this function prints this one. In another translation unit, you just included the algorithm, but forgot to include the speed header. With this, we don't know what dimension speed is. We don't know what kilometer per hour is as a type, because user was never provided this one in this translation unit, right? So the downcasting facility is not able to produce those, and we are ending with something like this as a result here. It's not only about printing stuff, it's also about the compile time errors and debugging experience, right? We'll see something long instead of something short. This may look really bad here, but actually this is how some customization points behave in the language already. Let's consider something like this one. We have some AB header, it has structure A, structure B, both of them having values, plus additionally B is having a pointer to A. We have some streaming operator that basically tells the compiler how to print that. And in one file, we provide swap on BB. And we decided just to swap the value of B and forgot about the pointers here. Or maybe intentionally didn't swap those because this may be some cache or something that's not important in the logical state of the program. And then we have A's, we have B's with pointers to A's, and we swap B's. As we swapped on the first value, we see 2 and 1 rather than 1 and 2, right? So we switch only the first values here. In another translation unit, we included the same ABH. We did also stood range swap, so the latest one, the most safe one that we have, but it swapped entire B together with pointers because the custom implementation was not provided. Right? This is the case for swap, for begin, for end, for size, for data, for any other customization point that has a default implementation in the standard, or maybe in some library framework, right? If library framework provides a default for a customization point, then we may have this problem. If we not provide our own, the default will be chosen. The alternative is in some different customization points that they do not provide the default. What it means to print any type on the screen, right? There's no possibility to make a default for the user. So in this case, if the user will not provide a customization point because streaming operator again is the customization point here, we'll end up with a compiler error stating that the compiler doesn't know how to print B on the screen. So this is what some customization points do in case when there is no default implementation possible or the framework will choose to not provide a default implementation one. So, solutions. Keep it as it is. We get speed as a nice type, as a nice text output, nice user experience in the error logs, in debugger, and it's provided when user definition is included by the in the translation unit, right? Otherwise, we end up with something like unknown dimension, exponent length 1, exp time, and a strange unit. Document the fact that the same physical system definition, so for example, the same set of header files, has to be included in all translation units. Because if you will have different set of headers in different translation units, you may miss something. C++20 modules should help, and this library is designed with modules in mind. Right? So, for example, all of the definition of SA system will be in the SA module, and then there will be no possibility to forget about speed when you're working with SA system. But still, for example, you could work with SI and CGJS at the same point, and you can sometimes forget about including the other one. But I think that's least possible here because probably you end up with some compile time errors anyway. So modules should help, hopefully. But right now I don't have modules in my library because CMake doesn't support them, which is a problem. Solution 2. Have a compile time error when resulting dimension or unit is undefined. So behave like the streaming operator. So there should be no support for something like unknown dimension. If something like this is being created by the compiler, just raise an error, because it should always end up with a user-provided type. However, it may be really limiting, right? Imagine some long calculation. You want to split it to some temporaries. So you have some speed, velocity, and speed sync rate, and you want to have a square root of those. So square and root here, right? And basically this will be not possible because this will end up with something that's illegal by the system. And this will not compile. Even though after square rooting this one, you end up with speed again, which is perfectly fine. And this is what you care. You don't care that it's just auto some temporary type. It's fine because this is not something that you are going to use. It's just a temporary calculation. If it doesn't look bad, look at this one. This is exactly the same in one line. In order to put something to square root, again, you have to first end up with this. And this type will not be provided, will not be allowed by the system. So I think this may constrain the library too much personally, but this is a valid choice here. And solution number 3. The user should be responsible for providing a specific type. So if you do something like this one, you will end up with this long type and a long unit and something strange on the screen. But still you can implicitly assign this to a user-provided type. In this case, you have to have this header included, otherwise you will not be able to provide it by hand in your code, right? So everything, all of the definitions are provided in this case. And this will then print and result and basically look correctly in the compiler error logs. Also, this basically simplifies the standardization effort a lot, right? Because we don't have to talk about the stochastic facility in the ISO committee and find out if it's good or bad. Because probably this discussion will end up in the committee anyway, whatever we decide here. However, with this solution, our function that we were discussing all of the time will not be possible to implement. Or at least we'll have different side effects. right? We got some length, some time. We divide them and print them here. This S will not be dim speed here because it will be just some long type and long unit. And the output here will not be the S1 as expected, right? So sometimes it will be harder for the user to write code that does nice things, what is actually supported right now. And it's only not about printing. Remember, this most important part here is compiler allologs and also debugging experience. So let's vote for the last time here. The voting started. In the meantime, I see in Q&A that regarding the first problem of strings, we have a question. Is the copy performance between 24 and 32 bits really that different to justify the size? It's hard to answer to me. I'm not the author of these libraries. I didn't do any measurements to verify the different trade-offs here. We always have to measure in order to do so. And I'm pretty sure that Howard did some, right? Choosing the design for LVM, and I'm pretty sure that DC developers also did some in order to choose the best design for DCC. There is no golden bullet here, as I said. All of these are trade-offs that we have to deal with. Okay, voting still continues. I will give you 10 more seconds and will provide the results because we are nearly out of time for the talk today. I see that with every poll we have, the less people participate in the poll. It means that either we have harder questions here and it's harder to choose the answer, or we are losing people. Sorry for that. Okay. So the results. 50% of audience voted for keeping the solution as it is right now. So using the doncasting facility, having nice compiler error logs, having nice debug experience, having nice printouts by default by the library, which will make my life harder probably in the ISO committee, but probably we'll have to deal with this. And actually, exactly the same nearly amount of people voted for 2 and 3. So 26% for number 2 and 24% for the number 3. Which is quite interesting here. So, as you saw today on four selected things, designing is hard. Right? Different customers have various expectations, experience, constraints. Often there is no golden bullet. We have to choose some several suboptimal solutions. And no, and never people will be happy because some always will find someone that will complain. Also, C++ standardization takes time, right? In order for the standardization to happen faster, in order to have better feedback from the people up front and be able to provide better interfaces for us, for you, for everyone in the C++ standard, we really welcome all of the early adopters for my library and others, because it's not only about me, it's about other guys, for example, the linear algebra proposal, right? Also probably have similar concerns that they want to standardize something, but they need feedback from the production. They need some users. We need someone to actually try it out and say if it works for those people or not. Naming is hard, right? That's always the biggest problem with designing. Naming is hard. Please help. Please go to my library documentation. Please read about it. Please use it. Please provide feedback. Please go to the issues and say something doesn't work or some requirements are not covered. But also, don't only complain. It is so great to see even post like it worked great for me. Thank you. We are working this in company X, for example, for half a year already. This is also really useful for me and for others, because if I will have a list of people that basically are companies that use this in production, it will be much easier to progress this with the standardization effort. Right? But so don't use issues list in the GitHub or discussions in the GitHub just to say about the problems you have. If there are no problems, please also tell us about your use case. So we can say that this is already proven in production and ready for the standardization. And with this, actually we are out of time. Sorry for that, but I think I covered the most voted questions in the meantime during the talk. If you have any more questions, please meet me in the Gather Town after the talk. I'm going there right away, and I will try to answer the remaining questions if you have any. Take care. It's basically great to be again on CppCon, even online, but I was about to be there in person, and that's actually quite frustrating that I cannot be there, and most of the EU citizens are not allowed to be there, but have fun on CppCon. There are still great lectures to come, and see you soon, hopefully next year in person there. Bye-bye.